You know what they call a quarter pound of cheese in France?
No.
Tell them, Benjamin.
Royale with cheese.
Royale with cheese. You know why they call it that?
Because of the metric system.
Check out the big brain on bread. You're a smart motherfucker, that's right.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Posts and Pints, episode 25, alongside Matt, Dre, Kyle, and Alex. I'm Justin. Thank you for tuning in. Go ahead and pour yourself a fresh pint. You deserve it. Topics of discussion, group stage recap, Cincinnati who? We'll discuss the knockout stages as well. And, of course, Florida makes the news again. Thank you, Florida Marlins. Today is Monday, July 27th, and with that, there are two games happening as we speak. San Jose is taking on Real Salt Lake City, currently tied. And following that game, probably one of the bigger games, I think, of the tournament. Seattle's up against LAFC. But before we slide tackle into those topics, we have a tradition on the show. First question of the night. As always, what are you drinking? Matt is continually dancing like an animal, wild man. Matt, what are you drinking over there?
You started early.
As always.
I most definitely started early. That's not even like... That's a shout right there. Nah, this weekend I went to Yale Terrace Brewing Company. Brought the old growler out.
I thought you were talking about your wife there for a second. Yo, Ball and Jane came along.
She's a growler.
I don't think I can get away with calling my wife a growler, but that's
personal, Matt. That's none of your business, Dre. Whether she's a growler or not. All right. Anyway, back to you, Matt. What are you drinking?
They don't do cans, which is like my biggest killer. They don't do cans, so you have to do like the growler takeout. But I got myself a nice growler of Blues Red Ale, and I am
very good. Quite...
Mm-hmm. Does that mean it's purple? Like,
yeah, it's purple.
It's amber. Okay,
I'm not understanding.
It's Blues Red Ale.
I can't understand your accent.
Also, I saw Justin.
All of you guys.
I saw Justin sipping from a red solo cup. Could this be the day? Could this
red
be the week?
Solo cup.
No, unfortunately, all of my tumbler cups are packed away in cardboard boxes for the move. And my dad decided to have the only thing out left for us to drink was a disposable cup. So I have a red solo cup. I knew somebody was going to say something about it, but unfortunately, it is high quality water. Somebody else go. Dre, did you mix drink tonight? What do you got?
I got myself a nice beer from the Czech Republic. It's called Pilsner Urquell. So that's what I'm drinking today.
Top bottles.
Wow. Cheers. Well, I wanted to keep it classy today. So I went down to the local alcohol store or whatever you call it. And I picked up a nice box. You heard me right. Box of Lab white wine.
Oh, and, damn.
It's currently in my 30-ounce tumbler here. Pretty filled.
Slap the bag.
Cup.
Gotta slap the bag.
That thing's full, baby. It's full.
Kyle.
Well, I'm drinking not PBR. I have Two Hearted Ale from Bell's in Michigan. It's an American IPA. It's pretty bitter, just like me. So I love it.
Wow, what a connection.
Is anybody going to drink, what is that, La Blue or whatever, the Canadian Molson to celebrate hockey coming?
La Bet.
Sorry, whatever. Is anybody going to drink that when hockey starts back up?
I'll get Molson next week. I'll get some Molson next week.
I do try to buy a La Bet every time I go to a hockey game.
Okay. Yeah. I like the La Bet, like, Devils thing they had. That was cool collaboration.
Disappointing. Just disappointing. Let's get it out of the way. Cincy beats RBNY. Matt, take this one because I just can't talk about it. It just hurts.
I mean, so I'll just talk about actually what happened, and then I'll let Kyle go on a Red Bull angry rant because I am anticipating.
He's ready.
He's doing the woo-sa. He's doing the rubbing the ears. He's Bad Boys 2, the captain. Like, remember your pressure points. Cincinnati coming into this tournament stuck to a game plan. Jan Stop, shout out. Man United legend defender. Oh my God. Fan favorite. But he came in knowing his team did not have a strong midfield, did not have a strong attacking force. But they knew that if they put enough guys behind the ball and just park the bus in the most aggressive way fashion. I mean, this is a team that parked the bus being up a man against a 10-man Atlanta. I mean, you can't take anything away. They're sticking to a game plan. They're going with what they're supposed to be doing. And they're succeeding at it. Park the bus, counterattack. And the Red Bull are usually the team that has to park the bus for. And the Red Bull were not ready for this game. The Red Bull were not ready to be the offensive team. And they could not break down that back line. Overall, shout out to Cincinnati, dude. They did what they had to do. And I mean, good for them, dude. They got two wins. Who would have thought Cincinnati would have gotten two wins all year? And they got two wins in this tournament alone. But this is exactly as I called it when we were doing the predictions at the beginning. Is I had a feeling that Red Bull did not have enough to leave this group. But I mean,
you can understand why I went against Cincy, seeing as how they beat a team that doesn't seem to have a system without Yosef Martinez.
I'm sitting here shook that the two teams that everyone in the world had advancing did not advance, and the two teams that no one had advancing did. It's just, I'm still shook on that.
Let me just give you my take. I have one thing that come out of this game is Jensen, and just why the fuck is he there?
Do we want to segue into this?
A couple games ago, everyone's like, "Oh, Jensen's the best," and that he makes a save that Lucas Rodriguez doesn't make.
Jensen looked solid, in my opinion, up until last week. In which case, I'm pretty sure Kepa is better than that.
Dude, he took the hat off and he became shit.
Ugh, oh my god, he dropped. Dude, Kepa has a less than 40% save percentage. Like,
you know what? Let's do it.
Is Salzy's alive?
Kyle wants to play
someone right now. Let's just go into this, right?
Going, Kyle.
So, I can't even say Cincinnati played a defensively good game because it's super easy to defend against the team that had no fucking shots in two fucking games. You have a coach that looks lost, a team that looks just, frankly, like they're not even soccer players.
Yeah.
Where do I start?
Yeah, this game, trash.
Sean Davis doesn't even have like the knowledge to lead the team, let alone any skill.
Didn't we not start a dedicated striker? Like, we didn't have someone who's a natural
striker.
Royer is not a natural striker. White didn't start. Barlow didn't start. Like,
yeah, and then
how
after
the fuck are we going to win a game if we don't have someone whose job it is, who, like, on the team knows their role and the rest of the team knows it's that guy that needs to score? If we don't have that player out there, how the fuck are we going to give someone the ball to score?
They put 15 shots on goal.
Honestly, like, again, we can go on for a while. There's a couple things. One, it's a good thing we're not a Red Bull podcast.
Hashtag arms up.
Number two, but this is exactly what we've been saying now for quite some time. At least what I've been saying is I don't think, like, being at the club for an extended period of time, being a homegrown player, being in the system for many years does not qualify leader or captain. I'm using Manchester United as the example here. Harry Maguire was bought in the summer and within 3 months was the captain of Manchester United. It is not something that, like, you've been here the longest. You know, when a store, here, I'll use this example. When a retail store is choosing a manager, they're not just going to choose the person who's been there the longest. That employee might suck. They're going to choose the person who's going to lead the team to success. And that's the exact same thing you have to think about with sports teams. Leadership is in your DNA.
Are you trying to tell me that Sean Davis shouldn't even be the manager at a Burger King? Because I'd agree with you.
I'm not tomato, tomato, or however Burger King described. Oh, I'm just talking along the lines of, I think that the Red Bull lack, and I think, like, again, the Red Bull, who last year had Luis Robles and had Bradley Wright Phillips, two major forces in that locker room, both being taken out at the exact same time, I think there is no leadership. There's no one to tell the rest of their team, like, hey, you guys have to get your shit together. You have to do this. You have to do that. Like, it's something built into your DNA. It's not something that, since you've been here forever, I guess we'll make you captain.
Yeah, no, I got nothing to say on that. I earlier in the year did say that I did see some leadership qualities in Sean Davis, and I've been proved wrong. So, yeah, no, he's not doing well in any sense of the word, whether the captain, as a player, as really anything.
Well, let's face it, nobody is.
Yeah, this is all around disappointment.
I can tell you somebody. Oh, go ahead, Matt. Go ahead.
I get we're talking a lot of negative about RBNY, but like I said when we went into this topic, let's give a shout out to Cincy. Cincy was a team no one gave credit really to, and they got wins. Like, they're a team that stuck to what they could succeed at, and they did exactly what the game plan had scripted. This is a brand new coach who is coming into a team that really didn't have an identity. And he is doing a really great job. When you really think about it, he's doing a great job. He understands that this team is not built for success, but he has to understand we can't lose if we don't give up goals, which is, you know, hey, that's day one stuff. If you opened up the book of idiots, how do you win as a coach 101? That's the first thing. You don't lose if you don't give up goals. Cincinnati, since this tournament has started outside of the Columbus game, hasn't given up a goal. They didn't give up a goal to Atlanta and didn't give up a goal to RBNY. Hey, give Cincinnati credit. I still think Portland is going to do what they have to do against them, because I think Portland is an equivalent opponent to Columbus. And I think Portland is a team that knows how to break down a Cincinnati, while Red Bull and Atlanta don't know how to.
A player that's currently... he's not a captain, but technically he is. And a striker that the Red Bulls should have kept. Bradley Wright Phillips, 3 goals so far. LAFC, Portland, draw.
A good draw.
He's impressing me, coming back healthy. Mm-hmm.
Go ahead, Alex.
I was going to say, I feel that he is the Bradley Wright Phillips that we had in, let's say, 2018. You give him the ball, he's putting it in the net. He's showing up to the games, he's playing better than he did last season with the Red Bulls, and I'm a fan now. Not so much of the team, but because he's on the team.
No, I mean, honestly, something to take away here, because there's a lot of, like, you see all over social media, like, why did Red Bull get rid of Bradley Wright Phillips? On paper, it made sense. Again, I'm not justifying the move, but on paper, it did make sense. He was an aging striker coming off of a major injury, who was the highest paid athlete on your team. I'm not saying you had to give him the same amount of money, but you do understand that, like, the Red Bull were in a position where eventually you have to cut the cord, and they cut the cord. And the Red Bull also didn't advertise that this was going to be a year for success. They knew they would have their struggle. Bradley Wright Phillips is really doing an absolutely amazing job filling in for that spot for Carlos Vela. Like, he's doing a really amazing job when you think about it. And, like, think about this. This is the craziest part. Once Carlos Vela comes back, Bradley Wright Phillips goes back to the bench, but defenses are going to be terrified that, like, oh, good, one of the MLS's top goal scorers is coming off the bench in the 70th minute, fresh legs, mm-hmm. and he's the guy who had to get that late goal.
Well, you know what? He's got to be making it hard to, as a coach, sub a guy who's been getting a goal a game.
But you're not gonna put Carlos
No, I'm not saying you start him over Carlos Vela. I'm just saying, like, that's a good situation to have.
It's an embarrassment of riches.
That's it. I was just about to say, Dre has the term. It's an embarrassment of riches. It's kind of like the PSG, where PSG just has, like, every position they have 4 players down on the depth chart who would start for the second best team. But give it out to Portland as well. Portland did a very good job. I mean, what a game. First of all, I had to drink an extra large cup of coffee to stay up for this. But, I mean, dude, it was a great 2-2 draw. They both proved that they're advancing for a reason. And I just want to do a hot take. I'll hand it off to someone else. But hot take, one of those 2 teams will be in the final.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't doubt that.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. That's fair.
Yeah, that wouldn't shock me.
After that game, I would lean more towards Portland, honestly.
Dude, Kesh FC, bro. It's going down.
Come on.
Oh. They're yelling timber. So, group stage recap. Biggest winners.
We just talked about 2 of them, for sure.
Well, I'll go first. I'll get it out of the way. And I'm talking about Columbus. Columbus did everything they had to do. Won all three games convincingly. Jesse Zardes is looking like the striker that the U.S. men's national team has desperately needed. Dre and I on the last episode with Young Americans Abroad were talking about how Jesse Zardes needs to be like, you know, if you're talking about a depth chart right now, he's fighting for that number one spot. And I think what he's doing right now is perfect. But, I mean, they're surprising their competition because I think they stay under the radar with their success. But I think the secret's out. I think Columbus is not only a force to be reckoned with, but a team that I really wouldn't be surprised if they found their way to a final.
I agree. And Columbus is just a well-built team. They're playing extremely well. And I think all of us can say from experience of watching these games for so long that even when Columbus isn't the greatest team, they're not an easy 3 points. They always give you a fight to the end.
Yeah, I got to say my biggest winner for this tournament so far has been Orlando. I really didn't rate them highly at all. And they snuck their way in the group stages in a pretty convincing fashion to that first game with the late winner in the 96th, 7th minute from Nani. And since then, they've been winning games. So it's there. I'm picking. I'm not picking them, but they're so far in the group stages my biggest winners.
Oh, whoa. I'm not picking them.
Yeah. See, I was going to say, I'm not surprised with Columbus, honestly. I mean, we in this household, at least, we've been calling Columbus as a winner since at the end of last season.
Episode one.
Columbus. They just took out Atlanta. They're here to play. Their offense is strong. Their defense is strong. Like Kyle said, they're not going to give up any points easily. I can see some yellow hanging in this house pretty soon.
So Justin, who do you think is the biggest winner so far? Or at least, you know, who do you think, wow, great job.
I was going to agree with Dre. Florida's been absolutely impressive. Everybody doubted them, and they're still here. So we'll see how lucky, you know, they can get to, you know, maybe get one more leg into this tournament. Maybe.
Maybe.
We'll see.
Maybe.
Either way, biggest surprise?
So that's where I was going to say, like, everyone's talking about Orlando being the biggest winner. I'm talking Orlando's being the biggest surprise. I mean, if you told me Orlando was going to be not only advancing, but winning their group in a group that had Philly and NYCFC, and that the game's already happened, they've already advanced to the final eight. That is absolutely shocking to me. Like, I'm not taking anything away from them. Great job, dude. They're doing whatever it takes to win. But the most important thing here is Nani is stepping up into that leadership role that he didn't last year. And I think that's what's the most crucial part. Because Nani is a Euro Cup winner, a Champions League winner, and a Premier League champion. He has the pedigree to succeed. The fact that he hasn't yet, but now is slowly starting to use his superstar pedigree to push this team to victory. Dude, Orlando could be in a position where they could upset a couple more people along the way, but hey, it wouldn't surprise me.
I'm not entirely shocked that they played well. I didn't think they'd play as well as they did, but because if you look at it, they had the opposite of the Atlanta situation going on. They started the year without their star player and looked like crap, and then he comes back and they win a bunch of games.
So Kyle, who's your biggest surprise then this year?
Surprise. Honestly, it's not like a major, like, oh my God, surprise, but I was a little disappointed in Kansas City. I thought they would be on a little more of a hot streak than they were.
My biggest surprise thus far isn't like a surprise, like, oh my God, like, this is amazing. It's the fact that NYCFC, below everyone's radar, made it through the group stages and then is in the knockouts, you know, in the elimination rounds here. I'm like, where did they come from? They were mixing Maxi Morales. Ibarra was nowhere to be found. The first couple of games of the season, they hadn't scored a goal in 2020 up until, like, one of their last games in the tournament. I just kind of forgot about them. I'm like, oh, crap, they advanced. Like, how did that happen? So that's kind of something that surprised me. It really did just catch me by surprise, to be honest.
I have an unpopular opinion, and it's going to be with you, Matt, here. But not like a, oh, my God, surprise. But honestly, looking at Philly, coming out of this. I think they tied one game, won the other two, but they've been playing solid. I didn't think that they would make it out of the groups in the beginning, even though I am a fan of, you know, their supporters and whatnot. But hey, they're going against, I believe it's Sporting Kansas next. And yeah, they're going to take it. In my book, they're going to take it.
So, Dustin, who surprised you the most?
I do.
I'll double down on Orlando.
Biggest winners and biggest surprise. Nice.
Yeah, I'll double down. Most disappointing?
New York. Sorry. Skip my turn. Whoops, but let's be real.
Oh, go ahead. There's no order here. There's no,
are we,
like,
are we not, you know, unanimously, you know, agreeing on this one?
It's
or?
That, it's that, yeah. I didn't expect much. I really didn't, but just the fact that we lost to Cincy just really, really, like, hit a blow. It was a low blow. So that's a disappointment.
I'll take someone else in that group, dude. I think Atlanta, Atlanta is a team that I think the most money gets pumped into in the MLS. I understand that your best player is out, but like, you see Carlos Vela from LAFC, dude, he's not even in this tournament and LAFC is still killing it. Atlanta doesn't have a game plan. They don't score goals. Like, the fact that they did not score a goal in three games absolutely baffles me. And dude, this team has zero identity. And you talk about disappointing. I bet you the plane didn't even land in Atlanta International Airport before Frank DeBoer found out he was fired. That's unbelievable. How disappointing of a start could you have? I really don't think it could get worse for Atlanta.
I'm gonna echo Alex. Like, personally speaking, with how much we're investing in this team, I am just totally disappointed in the Red Bull. Hopefully, you know, Red Bull does follow in Atlanta's footsteps and Armas gets kicked the fuck out. But that's the only really good thing I could see coming out of this. The Red Bull just straight up disappointed me. To lose to both Ohio teams is a bit depressing.
Breaking news. Chris Armas signs 6-year extension.
No! I'm moving to Columbus.
So, Kyle, who disappointed you the most?
Atlanta's a good pick. Me personally, like, I'm not going to keep repeating shit. The Red Bull thing did still stings a little bit. That's personal. Yeah, I'm going to go with Atlanta because I figured they would at least have a game plan without Joseph Martinez. I was not that I'm a fan of them, but I was looking up. I was actually looking forward to Pity Martinez maybe stepping into that role a little more.
And here's actually one interesting thing I just thought of about that. LAFC didn't know Carlos Vela wasn't going to go up until like a week or two before the tournament. Atlanta knew Martinez was out months ago. They had months of time of preparation, of planning, of whatever they wanted to do to come up with a game plan because they knew he wasn't coming back for a long time. LAFC figured out Vela's not coming 2 weeks before the tournament started, so they had to, like, you know, in the blink of an eye, come up with a game plan. And then
Bradley said, fuck it, we'll do it live.
Yeah.
But doesn't that even add to the disappointment? That's another reason why that Atlanta had the time to prepare for this and they didn't. Justin, who disappointed you the most?
Listen, so you guys were talking about Atlanta and I would agree with you. And then in my fucking dumb brain, I was becoming like starting to facilitate this crazy conspiracy theory that Atlanta just wanted to get the hell out of Dodge and not be in this tournament and just throw it. And then you told me that the coach got fired. And then I was like, oh,
never mind.
Frank DeBoer, I bet you the plane, like the wheels touched down. Like,
God, he's repeating himself already. You are an old man.
Oh. Wow. So,
what are you thinking, Justin? Who disappointed you the most?
The Red Bulls. It's my fucking team. Get into the playoffs. At least get in the bracket. Something. Do something.
Just a kid with the stick. Do something.
Just do something.
Before
we go on to the knockout stage, I hate to burst all your bubble.
Bubbles.
No, because you all have the same mindset, so it's one individual bubble. Red Bull in playoffs. What two things do not mix?
Well, like Kyle said, it's not depressing enough.
They mix pretty damn well.
It's like Kyle said, it's not depressing. It's not Right. It's not depressing enough for Red Bull fans to get kicked out of the group stages. You know, we got to get to the right knockouts, get a little bit of hope, and then get knocked out. That's more devastating.
That's the Red Bull system. You make it a couple rounds in, and then you fuck it.
Yeah. Listen, you just ordered a cinnamon bun from the fucking mall. You just got it nice and fresh. It looks moist and delicious. You got the Jesus Jizz juice on top. It's just unbelievable. You get one bite out of it, and somebody bumps you and knocks it and falls on the fucking floor. That's the New York Red Bulls. Thank you for joining us on the fucking podcast.
I was going to say it's more like you get it super someone. Fresh and you bite into it, and it's from yesterday, and they just never put it away.
Oh, it's dry.
So Justin, when were you going to tell me we got a sponsorship from Cinnabon?
Yes.
Wait a second. We got a sponsor?
you didn't tell me we got a Cinnabon sponsorship.
It's when Matt maxes out the credit card to start sending edible arrangements to every goddamn company on the planet saying sponsor us.
Somebody should tell Matt how much fruit costs. Seriously.
I don't know why you guys let me use the company credit card. I just feel like that's you guys dropping the ball.
Dude, there's just a bunch of fruit basket charges. I don't fucking understand it. What's your obsession with fruit baskets?
I don't know how much fruit costs, okay? I'm sorry.
Take it, Matt. God.
Yeah, it's just a bunch of fruit baskets. There was one charge. I think it was a blow-up doll. I'm not sure.
Oh, yeah. Boy.
That must have been for Dre.
You don't get double mileage. You don't get double mileage by buying fruit, Matt.
Wait, are you serious? Because, there were these ads, and they said double miles.
Fill up my gas tank, please.
Matt is very much that guy. Hey, guys, I got hit up by this Nigerian prince. He wants to give me money. He says we're related.
How? What are the odds of him getting an email from Nigeria?
I need 500 Target gift cards. Thanks.
You're past due on your taxes. I only accept prepaid Apple gift cards.
Bingo. Dude, knockout stages. Let's go.
My favorite by far is the calls I get about the warranty on my car. And I like.
Oh, yeah. Extended warranty.
I only drive company vans. I just drive around in my little cleaning van. I don't that's through the company's insurance. Sure, insurance is invalid. Yeah, I don't actually have insurance, but thanks for playing the game.
Yeah, I got one that said my social security number was revoked.
Oh, yeah, that's funny.
I've gotten that one.
So it was a good time.
I don't know how you would do that, but that seems like an arduous process.
So I guess we're talking about knockout stages. So let's just go over the games that kind of already happened. So we kind of described it a little bit before. Orlando took on Montreal, and Orlando secured a 1-0 victory. Orlando looked good. Orlando is shining in the Sunshine State.
I'm the only one who called Montreal winning that game.
That's
the
home field advantage right there.
That's home field advantage, and I'm calling it now. I'll let you guys go into it a little bit more. They're doing everything that they need to do to win. But I really think Orlando is my Cinderella now. When you think about March Madness, they're my Cinderella.
I'm going to agree with that one.
I'm still pissed I lost points on that game in the Orlando-Montreal one. But,
it's all right. You're first, Ray. Shut up.
Yeah, I am. Next up, we had, Philly beat New England? I think we all got that one right, correct?
Yep, maybe.
Everyone got that? Philly's on the bender, and they're rolling on.
We're Team Adam Booth here. That's what we are. #TeamAdam Booth.
Throw our support to Adam.
Well, when you talk about it, Philly just continues to look the way they look, and that's just absolutely incredible, dude. They're just absolutely outplaying their opponent. But with the roster New England has, Bruce Arena shouldn't feel bad, and New England should not feel bad about how far they've come in this tournament. They've looked
absolutely
really
not. Yeah.
And I'm telling you right now, dude, that's a team with a system. They only need a couple more pieces. If they get one or two more pieces, New England is a team that can make a run. And you know what? New England should be very happy that they got this far. And Bruce Arena is a man who can push that team. Dude, Bruce Arena wins. Dude, he just wins. And that team is built for success.
Give him a few years, that team's going to be scary.
Exactly.
The next one, though, NYCFC versus Toronto, that 3-1 victory. What the actual fuck happened?
Motherfuckers.
this really killed my whole, Team Canada vibe.
These Spurs came to
life. Really killed it.
But here's the thing. Think about this, really. When we were going into this season, NYCFC was a team that could score a ton of goals. And they could hold their opponents defensively. This is the NYCFC I think we were talking about at the beginning of the year.
They looked much more back to form in that game.
When Dre at the beginning of the season was talking about NYCFC being a force in the East, this was the game that we've been expecting since day one. It's only taken them 5 or 6 games, but they finally have started to get into this, and it's like, you know, it's about fucking time. It only also shows how important Maxi Morales is. With Maxi Morales being back in that lineup, dude, they are just hitting off on all cylinders. But at the same time, dude, Toronto looked horrible. Toronto didn't look like they wanted to be there. They looked absolutely all over the place. And I just think with Toronto, the hardest thing right now is they're so inconsistent. One game that they're absolutely beating the piss out of their opponent, and then the next game it doesn't look like they want to be there. Jozy Altidore is too busy picking fights with Felipe on Twitter. Like, dude, put down your fucking phone and score a fucking goal.
You're not wrong.
Might I add, just one second. Toronto, Canada, Team Canada, it's okay. We've got hockey back. It's going to be all right. That's it.
Now, I don't know if anyone else was up late yesterday watching the KC Vancouver game. I actually caught it from like the second half onward, and that game was wild in so many ways. Most of what I learned is from the commentary, and that's apparently Vancouver had like 10 plus-ish players out from like their regular starting lineup. They had to like bring up like player. I forget what it's called, but there's like general allocation players that any team could pick up if they're like low on players, and Vancouver had to like do that to pick some players up. They had a 21-year-old goalkeeper in who played a hell of a game, honestly. I think they kept saying Casey had like upwards of like 30 something shots, which is close to MLS record. And then the game ended up going to fucking OT, which in this tournament goes straight to penalties. It doesn't even go to extra time. So what do you get to say, Matt?
Dude, I'm telling you right now, for like, I feel hard. Like, first, this was the game goalies, man. Like, the offenses were going at it, but these were the games for the goalies. The goalie for Vancouver, Tom Hollis, holy crap, dude. He faced 36 shots.
There it is.
8 saves and still couldn't get the win. That's ridiculous. He was goaltending off of his head, but really, it was Tim Miala at the end of it all. 3 saves in the penalty kicks at the end of the game. That's when it mattered. Kansas City goes on. I think Kansas City has the depth to continue to push, but I really don't know if they're going to have enough to see themselves to a final. But you know what? Hey, we said Kansas City can go far in this tournament, and they have the depth to do it.
Yeah, no, absolutely. That penalty kickoff or shootout was pretty exciting in that, like, there were saves on both sides. That's honestly where Vancouver shot themselves in the foot right off the bat. First shot, hits the post and doesn't go in. So that's how they started off the penalties. And then Melia makes a couple saves. Then you had Vancouver goalie made one save, but it just really wasn't enough to keep the team in there. It really showed that the lack of starting players for them kind of hurt Vancouver.
Just to give an update, San Jose just earned a penalty in a 1-1 game. I'll keep you updated. The penalty kick is about to happen.
Oh, hot damn.
I'm just trying to figure out what hurts my eyes more, these fucking yellow shorts or these, like, acid trip jerseys.
I like the yellow shorts.
The kick is about to happen. I got it. 2-1 San Jose.
Why? My feet is definitely
behind. Yeah, my TV's way behind. He hasn't even taken the shot yet.
Yeah. All right, back to reality.
So we're going on. Clearly, we are watching the San Jose versus RSL game now. San Jose just took a 2-1 lead off of a penalty. So we're going to talk about some games that we're looking forward to. There are 3 more games left in the knockout stage, which is Sounders LAFC, Columbus versus Minnesota, and Portland versus Cincinnati. Which game do you guys want to talk about first?
Let's just go in order, the order you said them in.
Sounders LAFC. That's going to be a PK, Dross?
Dude, that game is going to be, like, if you're going to, I mean, it's unfortunate because the game's already going to happen, But
oh, my God. That was an amazing game. I can't believe I just watched LAFC just beat Portland 3-2.
Unbelievable. I can't wait to see you guys next week.
Seattle.
Pre-planning and know that I was right, and it was Bradley all the way.
I think most of them choose LAFC to win this game just because the Sounders did have a poor performance so far in the tournament. But, dude, Seattle, Jordan Morris, Christian Rondon, and that defense, dude, the Sounders can surprise you. And I really can't. If a draw was an option, I would have chose a draw. But, dude, I chose LAFC because, you know, just the amount of firepower they had. But, again, that's anyone's game. And either team who wins that game, they're putting themselves in a great position to continue to reach to the final.
Absolutely.
LA all the way.
Columbus, Minnesota, Columbus.
Oh, you already know the boys in yellow.
Someone black and just yellow are taking the game.
It looks like I'm alone again with supporting Seattle here, but we'll see. We'll see what happens.
You mean Minnesota?
What are you talking about, Dre?
Minnesota, well,
he's back on the Sounders game.
On the Seattle LAFC game.
Dre, I'm going with you on this one. Okay. Seattle just got a team in hockey. They got the name, the logo. They just got Jamal Adams from the Jets. Seattle right now is pumping. They're
Rain City Bitch Pigeons.
Yes.
You know what's the best part? Like, I reached out. Like, someone was like, yo, I would buy a shirt if that was a shirt. And someone it's a shirt.
It is a shirt.
Yeah, I kind of want one myself.
I'm like, dude, it's $15. I'm like, I've spent $15 on the dumbest shit on earth. I might buy a Rain City Bitch Pigeons t-shirt.
I'm surprised you haven't already.
Add it to the show notes so everybody can chime in and take a look at that one.
So we were talking about Columbus versus Minnesota, and Columbus has been firing at all cylinders, and Minnesota's looked like they've missed a few gears. I'm glad Minnesota's got here, and I really appreciate them showing up. But if Columbus looks like they did with the rest of the group stage, I think Columbus takes this pretty easy with all the players that Minnesota's missing.
It's kind of weird having this conversation because, like, if this COVID break never happened and Minnesota was still very much the team we saw at the beginning of the year, I don't know if we'd be having the same conversation.
Exactly.
Those fire jerseys, man.
I'm still sticking with the fire jerseys. Minnesota takes it.
They're missing their best striker, their best midfielder, and their best defender. It's tough to think Minnesota is going to be.
Anything's possible. We've seen so much crazy stuff happen in this tournament already. Don't be surprised something else doesn't happen.
Yeah, when you watch a coach sub 3 strikers in the 89th minute.
We got this, guys.
It'll be all right.
Portland is going to take on Cincinnati. So basically, the storyline here is, will Portland's offense get through Cincinnati's defense? I think they will. I can't imagine Cincinnati can really go 90 minutes against a team that is going to. Yeah, I think Portland's going to take this. I think they're
going to
get a goal.
We all know it's going to be Portland, but I kind of want it to be Cincinnati, so I feel a little better about myself.
Yeah.
Nope.
Just a little bit.
You can't have what you want.
No, we can't have nice things.
No, you're not allowed.
Not at all.
I think Justin can sum up this game for all of us.
Cincy with the upset.
Wow.
Justin, what? Wow. I had so much more faith in you than that.
Oh, no. I'm sorry. Alex wanted me to say Timber.
There you go.
God damn it.
This is where the Kesha song goes.
This is where.
No, we're not doing that. We're not adding her.
Going down, I'm yelling Timber.
If they win it, we'll add it to the final episode of the tournament thing.
Dude, if Timbers win, we all have to sing the whole song on podcast.
I'm fine with that. Wait, can we do our eye makeup liquor too? I'm about
it. Sure.
it's for Instagram, guys. It's for Instagram.
For the gram.
So as we get closer to the final, we will do our picks as the games are announced. Definitely check those out on our social medias. Final topic of the night, what is pissing you off?
Let's wrap it up, kids. You want to know what's pissing me off?
I got nothing, so somebody else take it.
I got this one. Listen, so everyone understands, about 8 months ago, I decided to move into this house with my best friend Kyle, right? Little thing about Kyle. Kyle has a funny sense of humor. Kyle can't seem to stop fucking making dad jokes about like all the time. Like, just, hey Kyle, what's up? Crack a dad joke. Hey Kyle, I'm going to bed. Crack a dad joke. Hey man, how's your poop going? Cracks a dad joke. And I can't. They're so good, but at the same time, I just can't live with this anymore. It hurts, guys. It hurts.
Let's just point out that the biggest travesty of the last thing he just said was me telling dad jokes, not the fact that I apparently like bust down the bathroom door while he's taking a shit.
Yeah. I was like,
the house is really normal. It's like, what? you guys have been in this house. You know weird shit happens.
I can't confirm nor deny.
In this house, you got to keep the door open because it just creates a nice breeze. The bathroom gets really hot. There's a nice window, like a big window in there. You got to keep the door open.
You don't have to explain. It's okay. You like the doors open. You're fine. Good for you.
I'd like
Matthew,
to talk to you.
Sigh. What is pissing you off this week, buddy?
So what's pissing me off this week is like, so the majority of my job is like I travel to 8 to 10 accounts a day. And during COVID and during the, you know, when all these non-essential workers actually had to work from home, it was nice because there was no one on the road. I didn't have to deal with rush hour traffic. My hour drive home from my last account only took like 35 minutes. Well, yeah, well, that's out the goddamn fucking window because I leave my last account at 7 o'clock and I'll be lucky if I get home at 9. So it's not essential workers back on the road. That's what this is.
Matt, come wintertime, everyone will be back in their house again. You'll be fine.
Isn't it sad to say I can't
wait? Second wave is approaching.
Yeah, dude.
Starts now.
No, we're on like level 74 or something. We're up there. Dre, what is pissing you off this week?
I'm starting to get really pissed off that in this goddamn house, I live on the third floor and the fucking AC never makes it up here. So with the AC could be cranked, downstairs could be like ice cold like a refrigerator, and I'm sitting here sweating balls and it makes no goddamn sense.
Have you ever tried a fan, my friend?
It's on too. The fan's on also.
That's all I got for you.
My balls smell and I took a shower this morning. Like,
wow. Okay. Well, you know what? I I appreciate you letting us know that. I'm super excited that you didn't mention your what do they call it? The flea market team or something?
Farmers market?
That's right.
There's nothing else to say. They're bankrupt and they're relegated. Like, what else can I say about that?
So you didn't start the GoFundMe page yet?
Can I ask you a rumor I heard?
Yeah.
I heard they forfeited their last game because the ball went over the fence and nobody could go get it.
Yeah, there's no ball boy. They couldn't afford one. So they're like, oh, shit. Okay. We're out.
Oh, there's that mean looking dog over there. I'm not. Game's over, guys.
That's also entirely possible, having mean looking dogs around the stadium. That makes sense, too.
The Ukrainian, bro. Like, oh, we lost our ball. We can't play anymore. It fucking sucks.
Hey, you have some teams like Shakhtar that, like, every couple years makes a Champions League run. And, you know, Dynamo Kiev that every couple of years makes like a Europa League run. And then you have teams like Karpaty. And then you have teams like Karpaty where they can't afford a ball.
Kyle. God damn it, Kyle. Those are words. Yes. Yes, they are. That is a good one. Kyle, what's pissing you off? You jolly green giant, you son of a gun.
To be honest with you, there's so many things that are pissing me off, and half of them I couldn't even begin to explain, even if I actually understood them. So, literally everything.
God
everybody.
God bless
everything.
You. I'll pray for you tonight. What's the update on the game? 58 minutes.
2-1.
2-1.
San
Jose. Sounders FC coming up at 11. That game will be over, obviously, by the time this comes out.
I'll be upstairs with my toaster bath bomb when this is over.
I'll be like,
me, big boy.
I'm gonna climb into the attic and like just like put some rope over there and I'll watch it from a ladder. So you know,
Junior, just climb to the attic. You're gonna melt.
Dude, what are you talking about? I leave the doors open. It's fine.
Oh God, Jesus. On that note, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for tuning in on episode 25 of Post and Pints. We'll catch you guys later.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you for joining us on another episode of Post and Pints. If you want to join in on the conversation or follow us on Instagram, Facebook, or Twitter, that's at Post and Pints Podcast. And remember, the banter is free, but the beer is not included. Drink responsibly.